to own it. Just wanted to take the time, learn all the things that I could about you. Now it's such a mess here. Oh, we are distressed here. Used to be so easy with you.
When I was just a little girl, I asked my mother, what will I be? Will I be pretty?
I made a promise.
Will I be
to take care of her? Like she's mine.
She said to me,
she is mine.
That was your warning shot.
Welcome to Sparkle Show. With us, we have Alexandra Sadeghian. It's so great to meet you. You've been doing so much stuff. I was like, been looking at everything and I'm like, wow, you've been at it for a while and you're very youthful. So I don't know how you got it all done.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about your experiences.
So I moved to New York about 6 years ago for college. And I've been working professionally in the indie and mostly in the independent scene in film production, as well as acting for 2 years now. So I work almost entirely in the independent scene, both union and non-union, as a filmmaker and an actor. And it's super exciting and fun.
So what made you decide to go that route?
To do both?
Well, and did you mainly like the independent route and all that stuff, or you're doing union and non-union? I know some people who do independent stuff really love doing independent stuff.
What is that? Say it again.
I know some people that love doing independent films really love doing independent films. So is that part of like what your draw, like what drew you to like go in that direction?
Yeah, I think it's the freedom. I like the freedom on independent sets as opposed to, I mean, I have no issue with any kind of set unless it's just like horrible.
You want to share?
Actually, no, I don't think so. Sorry.
You have an experience, you don't want to share it. That's what you're
But yeah, I like the freedom on independent sets. You get to learn a lot. So when I initially started working in production on independent sets, and then I started working as an actor. And I learned a lot. I learned everything I know how to do in production from film sets. I did go to a school that was focused on filmmaking and acting, but I still learned way more on those sets. And I think I'm very loyal to that because I see, I've met some really cool people that really care about helping people learn. And I think it's better than going to film school.
That's incredible. So it's basically experience over everything, right?
Yeah, for sure.
So what was your first step when you came out and you started doing everything in New York? What was like the first one that you went to? You started going to school, and then what did you do? Did you start doing like off-Broadway stuff, some theater?
No, I actually only did theater when I was in high school. I went almost entirely into film making. So I started submitting for PA positions, and I started working as a PA, and then I became an AD, and then I started coordinating, and then I started directing a little bit. And then I was like, I'm going to, you know, I had studied acting for a long time, but I was very weary to act professionally because I didn't want to be seen as like a stupid actress, which I know is like a thing that happens all the time with people, especially when
you wanted to know your stuff and not just go out there because you're pretty and kind of wing it. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. I just didn't want to be like lumped into an ignorant, like I didn't want to be seen as like an ignorant woman in the film industry.
Smart, and that's really impressive. It's smart that you even knew that that's what you might be viewed as, you know, not even being really in the industry. You kind of already like knew, you kind of had it already like.
Yeah. I mean, that's the world we live in, right? You know,
a lot of people are very naive to that though. You know, I wouldn't have thought of that when I was 21 starting and doing kind of that stuff. I would never have even had that thought process. So you're really on it. You're really smart, girl.
I think it was more just fear. It was fear of being judged for being an actor as a female. I don't think I would have feared it as much as being a male. I think there is a lot of like negative connotation associated with being an actor. And especially being a like young female that wants to be one. I was very worried about being judged for that and being seen as not a real actor. So, you know, and I always cared about film. I learned that I cared about film from a pretty young age. I found out, you know, probably my senior year of high school that I really cared about film as well as acting. I found out I loved acting freshman year. So they were pretty close together. And then I, you know, it just.
Freshman year of high school or freshman year of college?
High school.
Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, they both kind of found me around the same time and it just made sense to me to learn everything about it if I wanted to be on film sets as a full-time job.
Did you go to high school that was all about acting though? Were they kind of really into the arts or was you like, what kind of high school did you go to?
Yeah, it was a really big high school. I went to high school in South Carolina. It was called Wando. It had 4,000 kids in it. So we had huge arts programs. We had like the number 11 band in the country. So we were really into all of that kind of stuff. I did traveling theater competitions within high school. We did a lot of that stuff. And it was cool to be in chorus or to be in the arts in my school. It wasn't an arts high school. Like it was cool to be in sports too, but it was just all the programs were very good. So I was very lucky in that sense.
So what city was that in?
That was in Charleston, South Carolina.
So you did make kind of a big leap to go a few states up to go to New York.
Yeah. I never really planned to. I actually planned to move to LA where a lot of my family lives in Burbank. I'm Armenian, so they're all in Burbank. They all live in Burbank.
Yeah, how'd you end up in Charleston? That was in my mind.
That was with my family. My dad got a new job right when I was starting high school in Charleston. We moved from Maryland to Charleston.
You're gonna be the only Armenian in like...
Yeah. No, I was definitely the only Armenian in Charleston. I really think so. But everyone thought I was something else because nobody knows what Armenian is.
I know.
Are you as well?
Yeah.
Background. Yeah. I was going to say the last name, but nobody knows like what it is. I mean, more often because of the Kardashians, people know it.
Right. But I know now when I was young growing up, nobody knew what that was.
No, everyone asked if I was Mexican, which like, I mean, no, but what if I was? Like, is there a problem with that?
Oh, I get it. Anything, whatever group I'm in, mean, whatever city I'm in, if I was in one city and it was like whatever predominant dark ethnicity was in that city, it was a Persian city, exactly. I always got it. So I feel you.
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah, it was probably only how many girls? Was it just whites, blacks, and Hispanics and Asians?
Yes. Yeah, no, like no Asians. I think I remember like one Asian.
Wow.
Yeah.
Even now. Wow. That's crazy. It wasn't that long ago. That's crazy.
I know. I'm sure it's still like that. I haven't really been back. And there's nothing wrong with, you know, just whites, blacks, and Hispanics. Like there's nothing wrong with that. It's just.
No, but it's just so interesting because I'm a California girl. So it's like, I've grown up with so much diversity. I can't even imagine a world where it's like.
I know. It was. Yeah. I mean, it's mostly white. Like when it comes down to it, you know, it's, we say the other races, but they're all the minorities in comparison to all the white people down there. So, and there's nothing wrong with being a white person. I mean, you know, at all. It's just like, if you are a bad person, you're a bad person.
Did you notice that your ethnicity kind of helped you because you have that whole ethnic ambiguity in the film industry? I mean, and now it is a good thing because back then, before the Kardashians and everything, a lot of the casting was just actually whites, Hispanics, blacks, Asians.
For sure.
So now it's cool to be like, you know, you have the pretty color eyes and you could kind of be anything. Did that help you?
It helps definitely because everything now is ethnically ambiguous. I've literally played like half Indian, you know, I'm playing Native American in a series coming up. You know, I'm trying to think of like all the different, there was actually one time I played half Persian, which were Iranian Armenian. So technically like my family speaks Persian. And they were, I remember like the comments, they were like, they're whitewashing. I'm like, I'm literally half Persian. I just look like really, like, I mean, Persians aren't that dark, like typically. Like, they're very, like, light-skinned normally. Not light-skinned, but you know what I mean. It's not, like, dark, dark, dark.
Right. My boyfriend's Persian, so.
What is that?
My boyfriend's Persian, so.
Yeah. I mean, but, like, people thought it was, like, really dark. Like, a lot of the white fans had a very different idea of what Persian looked like.
And well, that's the same thing with Armenian. I mean, we're both Armenian, but it's like I'm one the dark, you have like the one the different color eyes. So I get like, you know, even though we're so small of a race.
Yeah.
It's still kind of like, you know.
Yeah. But it's definitely one thing in the beginning is everyone was just like, learn all these accents because you'll need, and there's like nothing wrong with it, but it was also one of those things that like you can get distracted taking everybody's opinions on everything. And it's like, am I going to sit here and learn 50 different accents or am I going to just
right.
move forward? And if I need to learn an accent, learn an accent.
Exactly. Because I think when the time comes up, it's like, then you can focus on that accent.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's definitely been helpful in this time as opposed to the way Hollywood was, what was it like 50 years ago when everybody was just blonde?
Right. Exactly.
You know, like they want darker people now. They want mixed people now. So that's definitely been a benefit.
So what do you do now in the filmmaking industry? As actress, filmmaking, you started as a PA. Are you writing, directing?
Yeah, I'm currently producing. I'm producing and starring in a feature that my boyfriend's actually directing and wrote. And we're actually a few days out from finishing our crowdfunding campaign, which was super duper successful. And
was that stressful?
What is that?
Was it stressful, crowdfunding campaign? Yeah,
it was really stressful. Like I wanted it to be done like from the day it started. We all did. And we have a whole team of people that have been super devoted to helping us, you know, raise the money and stuff, and they're all exhausted as well. Everybody's just exhausted from asking for money. And I'm exhausted from being asked for money. So but it was good. It really got a lot of buzz going on the movie, which was really surprising. I mean, I don't know, not, I don't want to say surprising, but it, you know, it's like, it's our movie and it's weird to have like all these random people that like want to know what it is now. And it's kind of beautiful to see that people are connecting with it and with the story. So it's definitely gone better than expected.
So tell us a little bit about the story.
So it's about a girl that runs away from a broken home to New York City. She reinvents herself and then finds out she has to go home and confront her dark past to truly be free. So it's a social drama, domestic thriller, and it deals with...
How old is the girl?
She's 19. She's supposed to be 19.
Are you acting in it as well, or you're just... So yeah. Who do you play?
I play her.
So you play the 19-year-old? Or...
She's 19. She's about to leave for college.
So you wrote it about...
No, I didn't write it. My boyfriend wrote it.
He wrote it. Okay.
Yeah.
So what part are you going to be doing that's behind the scenes besides being...
Producing.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's been a really fun ride. And that's called Bound. And aside from that, I would say it's mostly producing and a little bit of directing in terms of production. I mean, the producing has really taken like a lot of the time that I spend on the filmmaking itself. It's a very, mm-hmm. Very demanding job, especially as a new producer that's learning everything on the go. So, that's what I, in terms of filmmaking, that's what I'm doing.
You do everything. I mean, a lot of people don't know how much work all of this is.
Yeah.
How crazy you are to take it on.
What was that?
How crazy you are to take all this on. I mean, you can just be an actress, but you're like, no, I got to learn this. I got to be right. I'm like, oh my gosh, girl, that's the overachiever. That's really good though. I mean, I totally commend you for what you're doing.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. I'm a little bit of a try hard, but it's hopefully going to pay off at some point. And I think it already is starting to, which is super cool.
Wow. What did your parents think about you going this route?
We didn't really have like a discussion about it. I just did it. So I got scholarship to my school and then just, they were like, okay. And I just moved. And I mean, they weren't necessarily like, it's different. If you're not in the industry, you don't get like what it's like to work in the industry. So they don't, nobody gives the right advice, because it's not like going and being a lawyer where it's like, yeah, go to law school, take the bar, and then you go clerk or what. I actually know nothing about being a lawyer, so I may be saying
the yeah, there's bar, a lot of like, routes to being in the film industry, so many different routes.
Yeah, there's no definite way to get in. So they're like, yeah, go get a job. And I was like, you have to get, like, even as a filmmaker, you have to get, like, hired for one gig. And that gig may be a short film. So, like, it's, if you're a freelancer, unless you want to work for, like, a production company or a studio or something like that, which is totally, you know, something you can do. But it's, you're, like, constantly job interviewing. And right. All the friends that are freelancers, too, you know, like, you have to hop from gig to gig to gig. So it's like, you know, these people that are outside of the film industry, they don't really get that. They just think you get a job and that's it. Just like everything else, or just like a lot of other jobs. But it's like a constant grind. And you know what it's like, you know, you have to, you're only as good as your last like success, I think is what people say, or your last big thing. And as soon as you're done, even if you book a great movie, people are always wondering what you have next.
Right.
So it's not enough to just be good once. You have to do it consistently.
That's very, very true. I just was like thinking your parents are probably like, I think a lot of us in the arts, our parents, you know, are like, oh, that's cool. Get it out of your system. And nobody understands that this is going to be your thing. So
yeah.
So that's good that your family's supportive or they're learning to be. Are there?
Yeah. It's just like, I think it's just educating people and just saying like, okay, this is how it works. And because people say, oh, you booked a movie, who's in it? And it's like, all right, this is different. Like, this is not a studio movie. You know, like, you're not even going to know the name actors in it because they're like indie name actors.
Right.
Like, you're not going to get it. Like, this is going to be on Amazon. This is going to be on whatever. And this is not a Marvel movie. And everybody that doesn't know anything about the film industry is just like, oh, what is there aside from like the Marvel universe? You know, and aside from whatever big James Bond movies happening or whatever. And it's like, there's so much, you know, going on. And you just have to educate people that it's like still a real movie. We'll still get sold. We'll still air on VOD. We'll still do all these things.
Right.
But it's not the same thing. It's not in the same world. So I feel I'm constantly educating people, which is good because people hopefully are a lot more understanding than with more people they meet that are creatives.
Alexandra, where do you live now?
In New York right now.
You're still in the city?
Yeah.
Wow, so you just like, you went to school and then and kind of stayed there. Did you make good connections?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that I made connections and then I kept making connections. And then I was like, I'll work in LA and here, or I'll work wherever we're shooting.
But where is your family live now? Are they still in Charleston? Did they move back to Burbank?
No, my mom and dad live in Vegas.
Oh.
And then my dad's side of the family lives in Burbank. And then nobody lives in Charleston, but my brother now lives in South Carolina randomly. So we're all over.
Oh, wow. Oh my gosh. Are you thinking of moving to California, or are you kind of like being New York based, just flying to California here and there?
I think, you know, I love my family there and I love like the nature there and I love the vibe, but I think I love New York people a lot. And I think I've just grown to love New York people and be accustomed to them. And I think it's like, I love it so much when it's, cause it's always been like a vacation spot for me. It's always been when school was out, I would go spend summers with my grandparents out there and it was like a summer thing. And it's always been like the novelty of that, that I've loved so much. And I think that's kind of why I've kept it this way, where I live here and I'll go spend time out there.
Right.
And that way you kind of get the best of both worlds. But, I think there's good and bad on both sides. I think LA is arguably, it definitely has better weather than New York. definitely, I would say it probably has prettier people. But, you know, New York has very real people and it has like a certain, like, I don't know, there's this indescribable thing about New York that kind of attracts me daily to it.
Right.
It's I rough love around the edges, but it's really real.
People always think I'm from New York. It's really funny. So
really?
All the time, people are like, "You're from New York." I think it's just my personality or my attitude, and it's like, you know.
Well, I think the big person, because you have a very big personality, mm-hmm. which is a really great thing. And I've not met as many people from LA with that kind of personality as I have from New York. I meet people every day in New York that have these big personalities, you know, like, and when I go to LA, especially it's a different breed. It's a transient area, just like New York. So you get all sorts of people in LA, but mm-hmm. there are a lot of people I meet out there that are just like very chill.
Right. They say it's a slower pace versus the fast pace. Yeah. So I get it. Yeah.
Yeah. And New York is known for like opinionated, you know, like loud, like,
right.
You know, all these kinds of personalities.
Yeah, no, New York's awesome. I like everything except the weather. That's the one thing I don't like.
The weather's horrible in New York. It's horrible. Like, you don't move here for the weather.
So, Alexandra, getting back to the whole Armenian actress thing, do you get a lot of pressure to kind of implement that in your projects? Because as doing this, just having my show, I had gotten a lot of pressure from the Armenian community to recognize the genocide and all the problems that we were having last year. Again,
that was just, and all of that.
Yeah, and it just had gotten, I didn't jump on it fast enough, so I was told, you know, about that. And so I wondered what kind of pressure you were getting.
So right now, I'm not feeling a ton of pressure externally. I mm-hmm. definitely feel internal pressure as an Armenian to
right.
to talk about it.
Correct. Okay.
I don't think it's talked about enough. But it's also, I don't want that to be the only thing that people know me as. I'm fine with anybody knowing I'm Armenian.
Right.
Anybody knowing I'm like, you know, like I met a bunch of Azeri guys the other day and I was like, guy, you know, and I let them know how I felt and they like respected it. Cause at the end of the day, we're all from that part of the world. Like we are family. It's just all political.
Right.
So I definitely will speak on it. It's just one thing that I know I personally want to speak on it more as my career goes on. I think the country, I went to the country for the first time ever, I think it was 2.5 years ago with my uncle. And he's very like, very into Armenia. Like he, you know, he'll go there and he'll support people, you know, in any way that he can. It's really beautiful. And I want to do that same kind of thing. And I want to utilize, you know, everything I'm doing to help. There are certain things I care a lot about. I care a lot about the environment. I care a lot about mental health awareness. I care a lot about, you know, my roots, Armenia, and like the journey Armenia has been on and that not many people know about, unfortunately. So I'm very loyal to those few things. And I definitely want to talk more on them as my career progresses and I have further reach.
Yeah, no, I totally get it. I just, you know, I'm not super thrilled with all the like movies about Armenia that I've seen. I just feel like there could be more and can be better. So I was wondering if you're going to be that one to.
I would like
to. Take us there.
I do think, you know, it's like with the Mulan movie that came out, I believe it was like a white male director that directed Mulan. Am I wrong?
Not 100% on that.
Okay. I believe someone was telling me about that. And I watched Mulan the other day and I was like, ooh, this story was not told by the right person because I had no connection to Mulan at all as a female. Mm-hmm. And I'm not, you know, of Chinese descent. I can't even pretend to believe I know what it's like, especially now with all of the hate on Asian Americans and stuff. But I would have wanted more out of that kind of story. And I think sometimes when the wrong person is telling the story, I think that the message can be lost. And I think that's what's happened with a lot of Armenian stuff is that it's the wrong people telling the story.
Have you connected to other Armenians in the industry?
I have met so few Armenians in the industry, to be honest. Like I have met
over there, girl. I know. Over here. So.
Let's start a club.
Right. Yeah. We got to like break the bridges of the whole East Coast, West Coast.
Yeah, no, for sure. Because even in New York, the presence of Armenians kind of just stays in Brooklyn. I had no idea where they were. And then the other day, I figured out they're all in Brooklyn. And they all just stay there. I guess just kind of like all of them are in Glendale and Burbank in LA, and they you know have their home that they've made where there are literally signs in Armenian, and like, you know, it's literally Little Armenia. But I think I think I met one other composer that was Armenian, and that might be it. And I think I connected on social media with one Armenian director, but not like in depth.
Right.
I just saw his last name and I was like, you're Armenian.
You know. So where can we find you now and keep up with what you're doing? And if anybody wants to still donate to your crowdfunding, is that even a link up? Is that possible to still donate?
Yeah, for sure. So to keep up with me, you can follow me on Instagram. It's at Alexandra Faye, just spelled out the normal way. 16. And if you want to contribute to Bound the Movie, you can go to www.boundthemovie.com.
So there's no other Bound? I feel like that's just such a, like,
there
that
was
already. Oh, there was.
There
yeah,
was.
Bound the Movie.
But it was a very different movie. But we, for some reason, own that domain now. I guess they didn't buy it.
I love the title. I mean, I love it. I am interested in it, and I can't wait to see it.
Yeah,
what else can we see? Where do you put some of your past stuff? Is there anywhere that we could find some of your past things that you've done or been in?
Honestly, a lot of my past stuff is still in post. Having been
really?
Doing it for, you know, like, I feel like I'm always shooting, but always waiting for stuff to come out. And if I'm not on the production side of it, I don't have a say in how fast that happens. So I try to post everything on my social media so people can stay up to date with it. And, you know, on my IMDb, you can go and you can check out everything that's now in post-production. If it's released, you can see where everything is. Because I know it's, everyone goes at their own pace. So.
Awesome. Well, we want to keep up with you and see all the stuff that you're doing. Besides Bound, what else, is there other stuff that you're working on that we should be aware of?
Yeah, for sure. I just shot a movie, it's called Protège Moi. It's a really, really fun medieval vampire horror movie. It's Crude Comics. It's by Crude Comics Cinemas. So that should be coming out within the next few months.
Is that going to be Netflix or?
I actually don't know what his distribution deal is yet. I have no idea. We just shot.
Are you a good person or a bad person?
I'm actually a good person, surprisingly, because I don't look like one, but like.
I think you can go either way, girl. I can see it.
Yeah, I guess it depends.
I just got the vampire eyes. For some reason, I just thought you could be a good vampire. So.
They're scary. I know. I look like a vampire. That's, I always said I was going to play a vampire.
You look like a beautiful vampire. Don't get me.
But I actually wore contacts for this one. They're like crystal blue. They're terrifying. Wow. Very terrifying. And I'm working on a few other projects, a really cool mini series called Dark Country. So that one is a Western and it talks about a lot of socially relevant issues now, but we translate it back into the Western times. Guns of Eden as well, same director as Slime City. He's been around for a long time, Gregory Lamberson. We're shooting this summer an action movie. It's going to be a lot of fun called Guns of Eden.
You are so all over the place. I love this. We got drama, horror, westerns.
Yeah. Yeah. So that all should be a lot of fun. And
I can't wait to see this stuff. I really hope that you keep in touch with us too. And like that you're active on your social media and telling us what's going on every day.
Yeah. I'm also coming out to LA next month. So we should hook up.
Awesome. Well, I would totally love to hook up with you. So keep me posted. It was great. Thank you so much for being on my show, Alexandra.
Yeah, thank you so much.
welcome to the Sparkle Show. We have Matt, the Sax King Tuttle. I love you have such a long name, Matt, because every time I say it's a tongue twister, but I'm like, I'm so good at this now because I've been introducing you for so many weeks. It's like, I could be your manager.
Thank you so much for having me on the show. I really appreciate it.
Well, thanks so much for coming on. I've wanted you for a long time. You're one of the most talented men in town, especially like with sax. I think you're the most talented saxophonist. Do we have another saxophonist in town that like you go toe-to-toe with?
No, they're all dying out. They're by one. Not many saxophones in town anymore. Kind of dying. It's a lost art, you know.
You're a dying breed.
And breed.
No, it's like we have. There's like people that play the saxophone in their sets, but I notice they don't promote. They're not like known. Like you make sure it's there all the time, almost throughout the whole.
Yeah, I try to get it all the time, and just did a lot of porch concerts during COVID, and I was on 99.3, and they had me as a Valentine's Day present to do like this dinner and serenade someone during Valentine's Day. It was pretty cool.
Did they get to win a date with you?
Yeah, it was a date. It was like this date couple, and they had me play for their stuff. It was pretty cool.
Can people hire you for that? Can we just hire you to play for, like, you know, that's a great thing. That would be a great way to impress somebody, is to bring you as like the entertainment.
Yeah, definitely. The porch concert, sure. And then the open mics at 559 are going really well on Thursdays and stuff. Every 6 to 8. The open mics are going really well.
So what makes you want to start the open mic? It's great. You brought them to 559. Everyone knows my other job. What made you decide on it? It's going great, but I would like to know what sparked that idea.
I just grew up in open mic scene. It used to be a lot more back in the day, and I really enjoyed it a lot. And, you know, you get to meet people and get to hear other people play and perform. And in LA, you know, there might be talent scouts or record executives there. You never know who might stop by. That's how you get famous in LA or Hollywood or Nashville, is you play at the open mics and people hear you and they get a following, and then you get signed, you know, like Jewel. That's what happened to Jewel. She was from Alaska, and she got signed because she was really good at open mic.
That's true. You're so right. That is what happens. I don't know why we don't have more of that in the Central Valley. So thanks for bringing that. Kudos to you.
Yeah.
So what are you going to play for us today, Matt?
I'm going to do Summertime. I'm going to play Summertime. How long do you want me to play for? A couple minutes? Yeah,
a couple minutes is good.
First Bush presidency. No, I'm just kidding. I've been in fourth grade, so 1982 or 83. So,
what made you want to play the sax?
My grandfather had an office machine company here in town, and he used to take us to the Monterey Jazz Festival a lot when we were kids. So I was exposed to saxophone a lot, and like other kids wanted to play guitar or drums, and you know, they listen to Van Halen or something or other. But I kind of oddball, I wanted to play saxophone, you know, like I said, jazz is like the dying breed, dying art. So
But was it back then? What were people doing in the 80s? I mean, I would imagine that was a little bit more popular back then.
Yeah, it still was. It was still pretty much guitars back in the, you know, the 80s with MTV and everything.
I thought it was starting. No, yeah, it was starting to be really like metal.
Kenny G, though, you made it really popular again, you know, in the 80s. And you have a Kenny G story you were telling me about something, brother.
Oh, my gosh. I did say I would say it on the show. My mom is going to flip her. I don't know. Okay. I'll tell the story, but
okay.
So basically, back in the day, I owned this very lucrative company back in LA called Sparkles Angels, the Shot Girl Company. I had this girl that worked for me who is really intelligent. She graduated from Juilliard and with a master's in the flute. So, and I didn't even know they had a master's for the flute. So she had graduated for that. I don't know how she knew Kenny G. I don't think they really knew each other well. Maybe just, this is before social media was big. Not that long ago, but it was like 10 years ago. So it's kind of before it was big. So I don't know how they had made a connection, but I don't think they had ever met. But he said, I will send you out to come see me in Arizona. Was it? I don't even remember what city it was. What are the big cities in Arizona? It wasn't Sedona. It was like one of the big, I've been to Arizona lots of times. I can't remember. It was not Flagstaff. Flagstaff's my favorite city, but I don't remember what the other city is that we even went to. But he was like, I'll send you guys out here and you could stay, you could bring your friends. So she like brought me, you know, cause I like Kenny G and I was like, this is cool. And it was like for my birthday. I mean, it's funny. My birthday is coming up next week. So it's appropriate to tell the story. And I forget how old I was going to be at the time. Maybe like, 20-something. I would have had 20. It's not that long ago, Matt. So definitely 20-something. It was like 10 years ago. So I, I was like, this is cool. Yeah, hell yeah. We're going to go to Arizona. We're going to see some Kenny G. We're staying in it. He's paying for our hotel room. He's putting the bill. We could order like all we want, the room service. Yeah. So, you know, because, you know, we were eating like, you know, all the stuff and drinking, not drinking crazy, but, you know, just having like, you know, a few cocktails and something. We ate, we heard his performance. It was so beautiful. You know, it was just really just nice, intimate crowd, just loving it. It was just so intimate, so relaxed and great. So then afterwards, he's like, you know, how about we jam together? So she had her flute, he had a saxophone. They're like, let's have a jam session in your room. So he came into our room, in our hotel room, to have the jam session. I don't know what I ate, like during all this eating and drinking, having a great time, but I ate something that did not sit well with me. Say the very latest, you know, the story's going on. So I was just feeling really sick. And so I had to go to the bathroom and they're like right there, you know, when you're in a hotel room, you're in the room, there's a bathroom. It's like, it can't be any closer quarters. So I'm dying because I'm like, oh my God, this is like, Kenny G, but I don't want them to hear me like, oh my God, just having a really bad episode in the bathroom. So I was waiting for them every time they were playing. I was like, going in the bathroom, and then when they stop, I'd stop, and then every time they play, it's going. It was awful. So basically, yeah, kind of had the shits and had to play and had to deal with that during Kenny's performance. Matt, don't you love these stories? Aren't you so happy you come on the Sparkle Show to hear like Sparkle's most embarrassing moment?
Wanted to come on forever, definitely. Yeah, the best.
And to this story, this is what you get.
Oh, that's good.
Okay, back to you, Matt. Was that what you were expecting, Matt, or you expected something totally different?
Oh, I don't know. I guess that's pretty much some funny story. Yeah, along those lines. It's pretty.
That's why I've never shared it on national and whatever. I've never shared it. So I've never shared that much of a personal story on here. So you're the first one to bring it. And you've been watching my show for a while. So you know I don't share that much on my show.
Oh, that's funny.
So tell us about you. So you started fourth grade saxophone. You grew up doing open mic nights. When did you become like you became? Like what happened? Tell us, like take us through your 20s, 30s. And
I went to Berkeley and I was over in Berkeley and near the Bay Area. And I just went to a lot of jazz clubs and played a lot there. I was in the bands, all the bands and everything. And then I worked on cruise ships. I worked on Carnival in Holland, America.
Did you get paid well for that?
Yeah, it was the best.
You were singing on the cruise ships?
Yeah, that was a highlight of my life, but definitely.
Did you meet like celebrities?
Well, there were some pretty, that's, I think there was some celebrities that came through there. Yeah, I think so. But it was pretty cool to be on the cruise ship and be a part of something, you know, people from around the world and everything. And it was like the best job to have in your 20s, I think, because you meet people from all over and you get to travel and everything for free. So it was really cool. So then I just went back to doing what I did in high school, you know, porch concerts during COVID and just helping, you know, teaching students and stuff. And
do you even have a teacher, a private music teacher?
Yeah, I did have a private music when I was in high school here in town at Harvard House. Yeah. So, yeah.
No, but you've been mentoring, you've been tutoring kids and how to like play.
Yeah, I have a lot of students right now. I'm thinking about starting the School of Rock, actually, teaching people how to start a rock band. I've been in so many bands over the years. I know a lot about starting bands and managing bands and stuff. And there's a lot of people that want to be in a band, but they just don't know how to do it. So I was thinking about starting like a School of Rock, like that movie. You know,
I love that movie. That's such a good movie. Well, explain to us. I mean, don't take it like a personal question, but I'm always curious about how you guys make a living off of this. Because isn't it kind of a struggle? Like, it's hard, right, to make a living off being a musician.
Yeah, just mainly it's just education. It's just that's where you make all your money and stuff like that. Performances, it's hard because nobody wants to pay a lot of money for music unless it's a wedding, you know.
Right.
Band. Yeah, but it's just teaching as well.
And I know how much work it is to set up. I mean, I'm sure playing music is a fun part to set up, take everything down at the end of the night. I mean, that's so much work.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It really is. Definitely is. Yeah. Yeah. So you want to hear another song or what do you
want? So, with the cruise thing, how long were you doing the cruise ship for? That was like, how many years were you doing that?
About 5 years. Yeah. About 5 years.
And then you came back here and started mentoring and tutoring and then doing all the local stuff. Or did you ever live in another town where you were doing this?
I lived in Vegas before. I lived in Vegas. I lived on the coast, San Luis Obispo too. There's a lot of artists out there on the coast. And but yeah, Vegas, it's really fun. There's a lot of musical opportunities out there, a lot of bands, and it's just the best town to be in the world, I think. But I have a,
Some people that you met? Tell us about some of the people, like the performers you met. Like, I'm sure you've met some people that were big.
You there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, someone's trying to call me. Yeah, I don't know. I'm trying to think of the different celebrities I met, but there was a lot of cool entertainers that came through and stuff like that. It was pretty fun.
Well, tell us somebody, if these were somebody you had like a friendship with that you kept in touch with that wasn't somebody back then, but they are now.
No, not really. Just different people, you know, that went into music and stuff and mainly just teachers and stuff now. And they worked on cruise ships and now they teach and stuff. So it was pretty fun. Yeah.
Cool. So what do you want to play for us now?
I'm going to do Misty. That's my grandma's favorite. Misty. Thank you.
Oh, that's so pretty. You're good at playing on demand. Do you do requests like at some of these open mic nights? If people have requests, do you know a lot of the saxophone songs?
Oh yeah, I know a lot of songs. A lot of songs, definitely. Yeah, a lot of. You know, I used to do karaoke a lot of, and play saxophone a lot, so I know a lot of different songs. But it's off the hook at the 559 on Thursdays right now.
I know, I love it. I had a great experience, and I love the people that come out. You have such a good, like, loyal fan base that, you know, go wherever you go.
Yeah, the regulars and everything like that. Yeah, that's pretty cool. The regulars that come out, and yeah, it's just fun. They love to perform, and it's just such a thrill to perform. I know it's hard to, you can relate, you know, to performing, and it's such a high to give your art to, you know, to other people and stuff and perform, and people really enjoy it a lot.
I didn't get to test out your request, though. I wish I would have last Thursday. I should have said, hey, play this and see what you can. But I don't even know, you know, my favorite, like, jazz songs, I don't even know the names of.
Oh, yeah, sure.
That's the hard part, I think. I think we love the saxophone, that everybody loves it, but then we're like, well, what's the name of that song, you know? Because of those jazz songs, we just don't know a lot of the names to the jazz songs.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, people aren't exposed to the names. We grew up in a rock culture and pop and everything like that. Sure. That's cool.
What's your favorite thing to do? Do you like to play the songs that already exist that with the saxophone, or do you like to bring the saxophone to songs that don't have the saxophone in them?
Yeah, that don't have the saxophone in them. Like I do, you know, the Michael Bolton's When a Man Loves a Woman, you know, the remake. I like to just play over that song, or, you know, there's another guy, there's a violinist, Paris, does the same thing. He'll do like Sweet Child of Mine on the violin or something, other, you know. That's why I kind of got the inspiration for the Ports concerts and everything. So I'm just kind of.
And then Christmas time. Why is Christmas time a big thing, a big time for the saxophone? Because I know saxophone people really love it. Is it just that's the only music we identify the saxophone with?
Well, Kenny G's Christmas album was the number one Christmas album of all time. I think it's just instrumental when they have parties. Like people will only buy one album a year, a lot of older people, and it's just a Christmas album. It's just for the Christmas parties and stuff. They just have to have background music and stuff. I think the people think of instrumental music as background music, like ambiance music.
That's why we don't know the names of the songs.
Yeah.
All right, well, to go off the Kenny G story, as if that wasn't embarrassing enough, he was so, I could tell he didn't like me because I asked him to, you know, I just went off the people I knew. I said, hey, do you like Boney James? Because that's one of the only other saxophones I knew. And he got so mad at me. He's like, yes, I do. Like, why would I even bring him up? Like, that was his competition. So I felt so like, you know, they're just trying to go with what I know. And it was like, he, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Did you ever meet Kenny G?
I did. He played at the halftime show for Fresno State versus Boise State in 1993. I met him at the halftime show. He played the national anthem. That's when I met him. Yeah. So
there's a famous person. Did you have the same encounter I did, or do you have a much more pleasant experience with him?
Oh, no, he's really cool. He seems reserved, but yeah, he seemed pretty nice. Probably has people coming up to him all the time, but he's a really nice guy, you know, and he really opened the doors for a lot of saxophone players, because before then it was and people were just associated with, you know, with traditional jazz, classic jazz, but they opened the doors for a lot of people like Dave Cause to come through, and other, you know, Boney James, other people to come through and get their music heard. So yeah, that's really cool.
Did he know you were a saxophonist when you met him, or you kept that out? I mean, you just meet him, or you're like, hey, this is what I do.
I was a little kid at the time. I think I was only about 20 years old. Yeah. I just came up to him and told him I was, you know, here in Fresno and everything like that. Big fan of his. I had like every record of his at one time. He's a big fan.
But he knew that you played his music, right?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So, well, yeah. Too bad you guys didn't get to jam out.
Oh, what's that?
Too bad you guys didn't get to jam out together.
No, that would have been cool. Yeah. Yeah. That would have been nice. So sure. You want me to do one more song before we go, or is that it?
Of course. I never get tired of you. I can listen to you on the sax all day, Matt. So go for it.
Let's see. Yeah.
I love it. Matt, one more question though. Have you ever jammed with anybody that we know, like, or any bands that we know?
Oh, I jammed with a couple of people, like the local band Jaded, a couple of those people did like the solo, the acoustic set. Like I jammed with a couple of the musicians from there and stuff. And then Keisha's impromptu band, I was in just the other day, the last couple of weeks ago, I jammed with them and stuff. So. Yeah, I've been trying to make all the different bands and then just trying to sit in and stuff like that and see if they want to hire me to be in their band and stuff like that.
So, what's the biggest audience you ever performed for?
I played at the Tosche Palace for the saxophone player. That was a lot of people there. So, yeah. Over at Tachi and stuff. That's probably the largest. But then I was in halftime shows, you know, in college, so there would be like 20,000 people there.
Was that nerve-wracking? I've never had an audience that big in my life.
Yeah, I know, the 20,000 people watching you. You know, in Berkeley, we used to play for the halftime show for the 49ers on occasion, too, so it was like 40,000. Oh, wow.
Yeah. I knew you were holding out, Matt. You keep us up at the cruise ships. I'm like, I know you've had like huge audiences.
Yeah, it's been pretty wild.
Were you really good back then? Were you, because I mean, I know you grow as a musician. I know you grow as a musician. So how good were you even 20 years ago when you're playing for like the 49ers? Were you nervous or were you pretty good that you felt confident enough to do that?
Oh, I practiced my entire childhood was just the saxophone. I'm looking back at old tapes. I was looking at family videos the other day and I was just really impressed at how good I was in high school, you know, because that was my whole life was music. I didn't have a girlfriend or hobbies. It was just the saxophone, you know? I didn't really have any distractions at all. I just practiced every single day for hours and stuff. And
so you were a well-oiled machine by the time these opportunities came around.
Yeah, I was a little child prodigy.
That's impressive. That's really good.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. So it's good, yeah. So yeah, any other questions at all? Are you...
we all got to come see you Thursday night. Is there another regular night that you play anywhere in town besides the 559?
No, I'm trying to get some more gigs right now. I'm trying to get maybe start my own band or different things like that. I'm kind of figuring out what direction I want to go with because this one band in the tower wants to hire, there's a restaurant that's starting. I'm auditioning for their band, their house band over there. So I might have a gig on Friday. I just want to kind of grow up in my, you know, day by day. If I can do 559 and then maybe another venue too, we'll see how it goes, you know.
We love you at the 559. We never want to lose you. I just wondered if in addition to that, you were doing other things. But yes, open mic at the 559. It starts at 5 or 6? Do you love
5? 6 o'clock. 6 to 8, Thursdays.
6 to 8 on Thursdays. Come hang out with me and Matt SaxKing Tuttle.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you for watching Sparkle Show. So next week I will be in Kentucky and I'm going to Nashville, Tennessee for a little bit to see my best friend from college. And I'm seeing my brother and his kids in Kentucky. So if you guys have any requests of a place I should go or take a picture of or something I'll be bringing back, write in. And we're going to do some clips and stuff and fun stuff. I'll show what's going on. But the show next week will be all from Kentucky. Same time, same place, same live. But you'll see me there. So stay tuned for next week. Fell right in the moon.
summertime that felt right, drinking cherry wine with you. Just wanted to own it, just wanted to take the time, learn all the things that I could about you. Now it's such a mess here, oh, we are just stressed here. Used to be so easy with you. Now I must confess here, oh, I must confess, dear, don't think I'm in love with you. Winter is coming and I don't know what to do, and there's no more use in running, no more running to you. And I don't want your loving, I don't wanna be just friends, knowing all this time we were playing pretend, playing pretend, playing pretend.
It's a mystery.